Good morning and welcome to our service of worship here at Heritage United Church. It's lovely to have all of you here on this winter day. But the sun was starting to come out as we were coming upstairs. And it is certainly wonderful to have a little extra extended weekend for those of us that are taking advantage of a Monday off tomorrow, which will be nice. But we've gathered here this time together. We have lots to celebrate, lots to rejoice in as we've gathered for this time of worship. And so I invite you now to join me for our call to worship, as you will see on the screen. And we will begin our time of worship together. In the breathtaking mountaintop experiences,
glorious God, you transform us.
In the wonder-filled experiences of everyday life, through the overcoming of adversity to quiet endurance,
patient God, you transform us.
Through a willingness to take a stand, through an unwillingness to let the powerful get their way,
eternal God, you transform us.
And as God transforms us, let us join our voices together for our opening hymn this morning. God is here. You'll find this in our Voices United hymn books in the pew in front of you if you'd like to have the music as well. If not, the words will be on the screen. Let us stand as we are able.
Thank you.
Beth and I are going to share the announcements this morning. And I'll start out, and I'm going to get her to talk a little bit about our soup lunch. But we have had a basket at the back for our community food banks. We have been giving to a variety of different organizations, including the one in Pickering, as well as DARS. We had a great amount of stuff that Brian and Marion delivered this past week. Thank you for doing that. The need continues. There are bags back there that were handmade by Carol DeVere, if you want to use one. It's sort of an inspiration to fill the bag or fill part of the bag, bring the bag back, and the bag then would get emptied back into the basket, and somebody else could take the bag and fill it up. The need continues. It's not something that just happens once in a while. There's always people that are looking for a staple meal just to get them through the day. So if you're able to help out, the basket's up the back.
Yesterday was soups on lunch. I think we had 36 people, because of how many I counted. And we made $375 from the soup, and another $152 from the draw that Brian did, which is great. I think there's a little more coming yet, so
yeah,
pretty good.
It was a great turnout.
Yes.
Everybody had a fun time, and I think the draw is another sort of, it's fun to have
a
lucky
draw.
It's a draw. Tickets for $1 each, and there was some great prizes. Thank you so much for our prizes. Yes, Margo's got on an infinity scarf. That was one of the prizes that my mom made. So there'll be one more soups on lunch before we hit into the spring months in March. I think it's the 11th of March, but don't quote me on that. I'll double check, okay? So there'll be one more lunch, one more opportunity to try your hand at being a soup maker or a skirt baker or a dessert maker.
Soup eater.
You can do that too. Everybody is welcome to join us. Our Easter fundraiser. This is the one that actually Carol is pretty much spearheading, and she's been getting a little bit of help with advertising for Ben and myself. We did this at Christmas time, and now because, well, Easter and chocolate, don't they go together?
Yeah,
they do, right?
They do.
So it's kind of an interesting thing. There's books downstairs. When we make a certain amount of money or sales, we are at a percentage, we get a certain percentage of money back. We go over that amount, we get a bigger percentage. So we made around $500 towards the ministry of the church for Christmas, not even realizing you're going to make that much. So if you have little ones, or you're the little one at heart who likes chocolate and all the things that come with Easter, have a look at our fundraiser catalogs downstairs. And Beth, what is the, oh, and the order date is March 13th.
Yes.
Okay.
To be delivered before Easter.
Yes, so you'll have your Easter in time for your hunt.
Any other announcements?
I think I do. Yeah, keep going. Maybe that's all she's put on there.
That's all she's put on.
Okay, so then our Lenten study, we will be having a Lenten study. It's more casual. We're going to do it, and I did put the date there. So March 11th is the next soup lunch. We have ordered a book for those that were interested. I have a couple of copies coming. If somebody that did not order one but would like one, there's an option of e-books as well. And what it is it's daily devotions that you read, and that I thought on March 11th, for those that would like to have a bit of a conversation about what the topics have been to date, we will sit down at soup lunch and talk about it. And if we want to talk more, we'll talk more. Maybe on Sunday mornings, or every once in a while, we'll have a little bit of, it'll be a bit more casual, but that is what we'll be doing for the Lenten season. And this coming week is Ash Wednesday. There will be a Ash Wednesday service at our usual service time of 10 o'clock for those of you that would like to be part of the service. It won't be quite as you're doing now. It'll be more interactive. I've got a few different activities that you'll be doing. So the best I can, I'm going to try to set things up in the sanctuary. There's three different activities, along with part of it being a service led. If you'd rather not come at 10 o'clock, you want to come between, I think I said, 1 to 2, you could come and the stations will be set up and you can do your own thing, and I will be around, of course. I think Karen Chandler's going to be here as well. And we'll just instruct you on how to go to the different stations. And of course, there'll be ashes for the marking of the cross for either of the two options. So that's our Ash Wednesday service. And I think that is all my announcements. Yep. So.
And you were asked when you came in if you want anybody remembered in the prayer book, if there are any others to be added. Right?
Ron and David, please.
And Susie.
Susie. Okay. Great. Thank you. This Sunday is known as the Transfiguration of Christ Sunday, when a very bright light shines around Jesus. And those disciples that are with him are amazed by this bright light. And so as we come into this time of transformation, of transfiguration, before we head into the Lenten season, may we be inspired by that light that has the ability to transform each and every one of us in our time of worship, in our singing and in our praying, in our everyday life on this Transfiguration Sunday. May the light of Christ be with each and every one of us. Amen. Let us pray. We bless and thank you for the gift of faith, loving God. In some of us it is strong like an ancient tree, rooted deeply and rising proudly. In others of us it is fragile like a flower tossed in the wind, bowed by storms. In each of us our faith is your gift, not our own achievement, not something about which we can boast. It is your gift, one that we have been given to share with others. We thank you for this mystery of faith in our lives and for its power to transform the everyday. On mountaintops and in the valleys of our lives, you meet us there. God in community, holy in one, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And now I invite you to remain seated as we continue singing together, Your Love is Amazing, or Hallelujah.
Thank you.
And you know what the funny thing was, when I was getting this, I was struggling because to me this is not what I was looking for. Right? I guess I'm showing my age, right? A light bulb. And I was thinking, when you think about times when you've been trying to think of something creative to do, Benny always comes to mind. Benny, you'll be listening to this later, you'll hear this part. Benny and we would sit around the table during Stitch and Chat groups, and Benny would have these grandiose, like she'd have a gourd here and a tray here and maybe some ribbon, and she'd be like, okay, everybody, like, I don't want to be the only one to come up with ideas. So, you know, like, I've got a few, but come on, if anybody has anything inspiring they'd like to add that we could make, like, I'm all open to ideas. Right? It doesn't matter how much conversation might have happened around the table, or if someone left to go get the coffee and come back, or you've now had your treats and you're still thinking, it's not until maybe you go home, and all of a sudden, the light bulb goes on. Now maybe your idea's not as brilliant as Betty's was, but you had a moment where you had a light bulb moment. Well, there's a few that I came up with on the internet, because the internet's great for these. Perhaps the most famous example of a light bulb moment was when the famous scientist was sitting in his garden and noticed an apple falling from a tree. Thank you. Why does an apple fall down instead of falling up, he thought. This led to the universal law of gravity. Or one more. While doing research, I love this one, research on radar, Percy Spencer noticed that electromagnetic waves emitted melted the candy bar that was in his pocket. And instead of being frustrated by this, Percy patented what would now become known as our microwaves. That's right. Light bulb moments. Today is Transfiguration Sunday. Can you imagine walking up a mountain with Jesus? We don't know whether it was cold and rainy or a beautiful sunny day, and they're walking through the trees, and they're just taking this nice stroll up to the top, and all of a sudden, Jesus is transfigured. He's as bright as the sun, and you're thinking, I think there's a little bit more going on here than just a nice stroll up a mountain. Talk about light bulb moments. And that is my thought for today. I hope you each have your own light bulb moments. And if you do, share them with me. They might just be something creative for us to think about. At this time, we come to listen to the story, to be inspired by the words of Scripture. So let us pray. Oh God, as we gather together, open our hearts and minds to the music and movement of your word. Allow the words of Scripture to fill our souls with what we need to nourish and sustain us this day and always. Amen. I'm going to invite Mary to come on up. She's going to share with us our first reading from Scriptures for today.
A reading from Exodus chapter 24, verses 12 to 18. The Lord said to Moses, "Come up to me on the mountain and stay here, and I will give you the tablets of stone with the law and commands I have written for their instruction." Then Moses set out with Joshua his aide, and Moses went up on the mountain of God. He said to the elders, "Wait here for us until we come back to you. Aaron and Hur are with you, and anyone involved in a dispute can go to them." When Moses went up on the mountain, the cloud covered it, and the glory of the Lord settled on Mount Sinai. For 6 days the cloud covered the mountain, and on the seventh day the Lord called to Moses from within the cloud. To the Israelites, the glory of the Lord looked like a consuming fire on top of the mountain. Then Moses entered the cloud as he went up on the mountain, and he stayed on the mountain 40 days and 40 nights. Here ends the reading.
And now I invite you to join me as we share it together in a litany of Psalm 99. You see the words on the screen. The Lord reigns, let all peoples and all the earth tremble in holy awe.
The Lord is great, exalted over all nations.
Let all peoples praise the great name of the Lord, the one name to be held in holy awe. mighty King, loving justice, you have established order.
In Jacob, you brought about your justice and actions which were things right.
Exalt the Lord and bow down at the footstool of our God.
Holy is our Lord.
Moses and Aaron were among God's priests, and Samuel was among those who call on the name of the Lord.
They cried to the Lord, and the Lord God answered them.
The Lord God spoke to them out of the pillar of the cloud.
They had the testimonies of the Lord, and the decree that the Lord gave them.
O Lord, our God, you answered them.
You were a forgiving God to them. Wrongdoing.
Exalt the Lord and bow down at the holy mountain of our God.
For the Lord our God is holy.
Don't tell anyone what you have seen until the Son of Man has been raised from the dead. God bless our readings from the scriptures this morning. Amen. Let us stand as we are able now and share together our hymn, Spirit, Spirit of Gentleness, number 375 on our hymn books. Probably heard me Brantford, moving out to Vancouver. Having been born there and having some of his family living on the West Coast, he's always been drawn to what the area offers. The mountains, the ocean, the trails, the breathtaking parkland, and more laid-back way of living. Well, this past summer and fall, one of his latest interests was to get out and hike the trails of the area. Some of the pictures of the peaks he reached were breathtaking. And when Steve and I were visiting with him in August, we spent much of our time together doing just this. I have some of the most amazing photos now hanging on our wall because of the hikes that we took together and of the beautiful scenery that we saw. With the addition of some new friends now, he's had some more opportunities to explore the great outdoors with those that know the area just a little bit better than he does. And one of these took place just a few weeks ago when he and a group of his friends decided to hike up to Brian Waddington's hut. This is a hut located between two mountains in the Pemberton Valley, a small town about 45 minutes north of Whistler, BC. The hut was built in the summer of 1998. It's not very big. In fact, one website that I saw said it can sleep up to 31 sardines. Only if they're positioned properly. The fee for staying in the night is a whopping $10 per person. Now, there are a few luxuries provided for this fee, which include an outhouse and the water that can be collected from a nearby stream throughout the year. Coleman stoves and lanterns are provided, but visitors must bring in their own fuel. The hut does not have any heating or lighting because of just the lanterns. And it sounds, you know what? Right up my alley. No, not at all. Yeah, yeah, maybe back to that. But just wait, the story continues. You may change your mind in a minute.
Remember the other house.
Yeah.
Now, the big question, of course, is how do you get there? Well, this can only be achieved from the Pemberton Valley by hiking or skiing approximately 1,000 meters of vertical gain for about 10 kilometers. Once you reach the hut, the backcountry skiing and snowboarding around it is excellent and it caters to all different abilities. Well, Andrew was very excited to be going on this trip with his new group of friends. He was well prepared with his poles and his ski gear and an avalanche kit and satellite phone, food to eat when he got there, and of course a sleeping bag to stay the night. He started out very early on the Saturday morning to make sure there was plenty of daylight hours to reach the hut. Upon arriving to the area, they soon realized that the parking close to the start of the hiking trail, well, it was not going to be possible. There was just too much snow. So what should have been a 10-kilometer hike turned into over 15 kilometers. Or about nine miles for those of you that prefer that. Again, this is definitely a no for me. So what would have been about a 3-hour hike on a nice summer day turned into more than 8 hours. The ascent began on trails that other hikers had been on, and from there the way ahead was a long, sloping face covered with snow, making it very difficult to gain a firm foothold, even with snowshoes or Andrew was wearing a splitboard. But that didn't stop them, young people, you know, as they were. Unfortunately, well, Andrew ran out of steam about 45 minutes before reaching the hut, he told us later. It's a good thing I didn't know at the moment. He was forced to reach out for help, and with the help of his friend Max, he reached the hut finally, very cold, very tired, and hungry. But I'm sure that once he stood at the top, he was thrilled with a sense of accomplishment and wonder as he looked back at the world below. What a humbling and transformational mountaintop experience. One that I'm sure he will not ever forget, and one he will likely train for before trying again in the cold of a winter day. You know, I can't deny that there is something special about mountains. I think there has always been, for me as well, Mountains create their own weather systems and defy the prevailing winds. They create their own clouds. There's something mysterious and inspiring about them, especially to a bunch of city folk. And for those individuals who have the strength to climb them or the good fortune to have a helicopter, mountaintops provide a different vantage point and a new perspective on life in general. Mount Tabor in Israel is one site where pilgrims are told that the Transfiguration took place. Today, you can actually ride to the top where, wouldn't you know, there are two churches. The Roman Catholic Church of the Transfiguration and the Eastern Sanctuary of the Orthodox Church. Here, too, clouds from the Mediterranean and from the winds drifting along the north of the Sea of Galilee carry much potential for transfiguration. It is here that Jesus took with him Peter and James and his brother John and led them up to the high mountaintop. What better place to go than a mountaintop to get away from the stresses of the world and find a new perspective on things. They trudged up the trail to the heights where they could look down at the world about them. I can't help but wonder what the view was like from the heights of the mountain they climbed. As the sun set in the west over the Mediterranean Sea, in the distance, they could look out at the darkness as it descended and see the twinkling lights of the coastal villages. To the southwest, they could look out beyond the Sea of Galilee and see the lights of Nazareth. I wonder if Jesus thought about his family living down there and how they were doing. Would they approve of their son's life so far? Would they advise Jesus to stop wandering and go back home and take care of his family matters instead? Then he could look farther south to see south where he might have wondered if the shimmer of lights off in the distance were Jerusalem itself. What would await him there? There was the temple that he loved, the gleaming temple that he had visited as a child, the place where he'd felt the awesome power of God. But there was also the petty Roman bureaucrat named Pilate, a garden called Gethsemane, and a hill called Golgotha, and all of them waited for him there. He could get a better perspective on things from the mountaintop. Up on the mountaintop where Jesus took his three friends, something profound happened. We may not be able to completely understand what we term the Transfiguration. We can say this: clearly, there was a spiritual experience that happened on the mount that stands behind this extraordinary story. That transformation isn't a small thing by any means. Jesus stood on that mountaintop, contemplating his own impending future of transformation. It was a moment like no other when nothing else could be seen. A moment that held the entire world and all of life. Nothing else mattered. Not because it was excluded or unimportant, but because everything belongs. Everything that is included in that moment, it is a moment of union with God. That is what happened to Peter, to James, and John on the mountain. They looked up and saw Jesus. Jesus did not become something he was not before that night on the mountain. He was filled with the glory of God, radiating the divine light. Jesus didn't change and become something new, but I do believe the disciples did. Their sight was healed, their vision was corrected, their blindness was removed. They saw the world transfigured, capable of revealing the beauty of God's holiness. They experienced all of life and certain of creation in that moment. They saw and experienced life in the world as God sees and intends it to be. The scripture of the story of the Transfiguration reads like a historical event, yet it is completely otherworldly. It is so rich in symbolism. But to me, it doesn't matter whether you experience the story literally or as a kind of metaphor or a parable. Its significance is that the story involves a journey up a mountain. In scripture, mountains are sacred. They always have been. Moses received the Ten Commandments on Mount Sinai. Mountains were significant because of the ancient belief of a three-tiered universe in which God resided in heaven down above the sky. Therefore, a mountaintop brought human beings closer to God. That is why Matthew tells us that Jesus took the disciples to a place where heaven and earth were in close proximity. Celtic tradition calls it a thin place. But there's also the sense of wonder when you reach a geographically high spot or even a very tall building. You look down at the world and you see tiny cars and trains and buildings spread out below you. No wonder we use the expression on top of the world for feelings of pleasure or elation. The expression mountaintop experience comes directly from the story of the Transfiguration. Mountaintop experiences like Transfiguration might, you know, include days we got married or graduated from high school or university. And then it also might be the first day at our dream job or the time we ran a mile in under 5 minutes. Well, not likely, but it would be great, wouldn't it? You see, the emotional intensity in the face of a winning a World Series or a Stanley Cup team, those players are probably never the same afterward. But most of life is spent on the lower slopes and in the valleys. It's not that these physical or emotional places are bad, they just don't have the intensity of the mountaintop. When you come down from the mountain, everything's back to as it was, in normal size. You are no longer a god on Mount Olympus, looking down on the ant-like earthlings below. In our scripture story, you can say that Jesus and his friends just went for a walk up a mountain. However, their walk was intentional. It was not a stroll. It was a climb, a pilgrimage to the top of a mountain. This is the line from a familiar hymn. "Sister, let me be your servant." And we are pilgrims on a journey, fellow travelers on the road. And for me, this helps because it puts things in perspective to allow me to see more clearly what this is all about. However, we do not know where our particular journey in life will lead us. That's why the next line of the same hymn is also so important. We are here to help each other, share the mile, and bear the load. Human beings are social animals. We all fear loneliness and isolation. When times are bad, we need the help of other people to walk with us, just to be with us. They can't necessarily do anything, but their mere presence may be exactly what we need. And that's the great thing about belonging to a church, the sense of community and fellowship. At its best, a Christian community like Heritage United is like an extended family. People you can count on for help at those times when life goes not so smoothly. For some, it's just hearing the right words of encouragement from a friend in difficult times of transition when we can see the writing on the wall and wonder if all the time and energy and commitment we have put into something had been worth all of it, or was it just for nothing? A friend that I'm blessed to have said to me recently, "Lorrie, you have been such a strength to me during some of the most difficult times of my life. You've given me a great gift. I know I can always reach out to you and you will be there for me." Today, we heard the story that we can take with us when we leave here. It tells us that no one has to go up the mountain alone. And it tells us that some things get really scary before they get holy. Above all, it tells you that there is someone standing in the center of the cloud with us, shining so brightly. And he is something we may never be able to wrap our minds around, but who is worth listening to all the same, because he is God's beloved, and we are his, and whatever comes next, we will be up to the challenge. And maybe the challenge is something as simple as, and yet as profound, as seeing God glow in all things and all people, and allowing that to lead us. And this will bring us life and the transformation that we needed all along. May it be so. Let us pray. Holy One, you are revealed to us in ordinary and yet extraordinary ways, and we are transformed moment by moment. Help us to recognize your glory, and with thanksgiving seek to share the gift of your love with others this day and the days to come. To offer back however we can, whether it might be providing for those in need with our community food banks, and also for the ministry of this congregation. And so at this time, our offering will be brought forward, and as it is, let us stand as we are able. We will be singing together, "Praise God, for whom all blessings flow," as our offering is brought. Empower the Church, O God, throughout the world in its life and witness. Break down the barriers that divide, that united in your truth and love, the Church may confess your name, sit together at one table, and serve you in common ministry. Gracious God, guide the rulers of the nations. Move them to set aside their fear and greed and vain ambition. Inspire them to strive for peace and justice, that all your children may dwell secure, free of war and injustice. As early signs of spring are emerging, restore among us a love of the earth you created for our home, O God. Help us to live in harmony with all of your creation, so that everything you have made, your whole creation, may resound in an anthem of praise to your glorious name. Loving God, look with compassion on all who suffer. Sustain those among us who need your healing touch. Uphold all who suffer in body or mind, not only those we know and love, but also those known only to you, that they may know the peace and joy of your supporting care. This day we take a moment to lift to prayer those who weigh heaviest on our hearts this day, as we pray for Myrna and Lynn, for Ellie, for Bob and Marilyn, for John and Carla, for Victor and Michaela, for Alice, for Gail, for Dave, for Ron, for David, and for Suvi. O God, in your loving purpose, answer our prayers and fulfill our hopes in all things for which we pray. Give us that we seek to bring about for the sake of Jesus, who taught us to pray, praying together now. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now I invite you to stand as you're able. Let us join together for our closing hymn this morning, I Am the Light of the World, number 87 in our hymn books. that begins with joining us for our time of fellowship downstairs. Let us share together in our benediction. Mountaintop experiences are wonderful. There is so much to see, but you are called now to go to the valley where there is much to be done. You are not alone. God goes with you, bringing healing, hope, and peace. Go now in God's peace and let it flood through you to others. Amen and amen.